Let's start with the most recent paper and this question of what's different about urbanization in the developing world right now.
So when I think about the remarkable rise of an urbanized planet, I think in some sense the most amazing thing is the fact that we have such an abundance of very poor, very urbanized countries. If you go back to 1960, there was essentially no such thing as a country with a per capita GDP less than $2,000 in modern dollars that was highly urbanized. To be poor was to be rural, which had been true throughout almost all of history. This is no longer the case. And I think there's several things that are going on simultaneously. On one level, it's reminding us of the extraordinary power that cities have to transform lives and society, provide pathways out of poverty into prosperity. That's something that cities have long had. But it's also, I think, a sign of a relaxation of constraints which previously stopped urbanization from developing in poor places. So if you think about the U.S. didn't become 50% urbanized until the 1920s, when our per capita incomes were about $7,500 in modern dollars. You know, China reached that number when it was about $4,500. It's the same for Korea. Kinshasa, the Democratic Republic of Congo, is at 350, right, as it's careening towards 50% urbanization. Port-au-Prince, Haiti, is at $1,000. I mean, much lower levels of income. And one of the differences is that the U.S. historically had to feed its own cities, had to have a degree of agricultural surplus, had to have a transportation network to move that corn, and that required a certain level of development. And with enough prosperity, with enough income, with enough good management, you can deal with almost anything. But where does that leave Port-au-Prince? Where does that leave Kinshasa? And that's very much the challenge of the 21st century, is how to make these cities, you know, livable as well as prosperous.
Yeah, yeah. But so a way to make this the fact striking is to look at low levels of income and then high levels of urbanization. But the really interesting phenomenon is low levels of government capacity combined with high levels of urbanization. And I think trade is part of that, but also these flows of technology. So you're getting some flows of technology, like most strikingly in health, where it doesn't take any local government capacity to get big improvements in health. So we're seeing a lot more convergence in health outcomes, like life expectancy around the world, than we're seeing in something like GDP. One other thing I think we could look to is the possibility that even if many cities are not well governed and there's this equilibrium that's involves special dealing and cronyism and so forth, if there's competition between these cities, you might get a leader somewhere who sees that moving to the efficiency frontier, doing the thing that could actually make everybody better off, could be a successful strategy. So, you know, particularly if you think of the biggest countries of the world, so China and India, the United States, Europe, if it can achieve more real mobility, we might start to see more active competition, literally by people voting with their feet, and that might create an opening for a few leaders to pursue a strategy where they really try and ask, how could we bring in more effective governance, even if it's going to disrupt, you know, existing patterns of corruption and influence, because the overall gains will just be so large.
I think certainly the competition among U.S. cities has been a big asset, I think, in pushing for good government in many ways. And I could imagine this playing out in China as well. I mean, China has many possibilities in the next 20 or 30 years. Some of them are very bright, including, you know, competition among effective cities competing with competent local governments to make things better. There's certainly a possibility. There are, of course, much darker possibilities for China as well. India has this challenge, which is local control, at least outside of Delhi, right? Because in fact, the underrepresentation of Mumbai voters in the Maharashtra state legislature is enormous, and the degree of local freedom there is very, very limited. So the ability of these cities to actually have this, you know, vision, I think, does require some sort of differential institutional arrangement. Now, Delhi has this, right, by having a relatively independent control. One of the things that was associated with sort of the slower urbanization that happened in the West was that we could think about cities as being relatively permanent things, where structures, I mean, if we look around us, there are an abundance of structures that are 100, even 150 years old, right? When we think about the developing cities of the poor world today, it's hard to think of any structure that you're building for Kinshasa today that will be appropriate in 30 years unless things go terribly wrong. I mean, it also argues for different technologies, right? So, for example, the more you value flexibility, the more you presumably like buses relative to trains, right? So, if you think you're fixed within a particular spatial structure for the next 100 years, then by all means, build the IRT. Stay fixed with it. If you think you've got very little idea of what you're going to do, then bus rapid transit starts looking much more attractive because it scales up or scales down. I mean, one of my favorite sort of symbols of urban flexibility is the use of shipping containers as retail, something that is being done by Tony Hsieh and Zappos in Las Vegas, or Christchurch did it in the wake of the earthquake, because they put a lot of retail in these temporary containers. I'm not actually advocating containers as being a large-scale solution to the retailing problems of the developing world, but symbolically it sort of suggests the importance of recognizing the need for flexibility and the need for not permanence. And if anything, it even also reminds us that in many of these areas you want to think about development ultimately as being led by human capital even more than by physical capital.
We're one of the things we're trying to do in the urbanization project, which is focusing on the developing world, is bridge this big divide that exists between traditional urban planners and economists. And this is partly over, the economists conceding, there's an important role for the state. But from the urban planner side, I think they need to recognize that there's a dynamic character to these cities that mean you can't plan for a static outcome. You have to plan for a process. So here's a question for you. How much building up is too much?
Look, it's important to note that it's not as if I've ever actually advocated for building higher when the market wouldn't support it. I've argued for fewer regulations restricting building, right? So it's not as if I'm an advocate of building, subsidizing the building of skyscrapers. But I do think that we have almost assuredly paid too little attention to the downsides of restricting building up.
If we're going to have 70 million new urban residents, it's conceivable that some of them could move back to Detroit.
We've got to
solve the crime problem. I think we cannot overstate how important crime is as a deterrent to city life. But it doesn't all have to be Houston and the Sun Belt. There are places like Detroit, Cleveland, that if they got their act together, they could compete as well. So
sure, and there are certainly Pittsburgh. There are plenty of places, including New York, which looked far bleaker than they do today. And this does happen, but sadly, Detroit still has more than a bit of way to go.
Yeah, so we don't want to give politicians a pass for producing one unit of affordable housing, mm-hmm. and we also don't want to give them a pass because they're not in the Sun Belt.
I agree completely.
If things don't turn out well, it's their fault.
So. Yes.
Thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you, Paul. Here.